Friends, today we are looking at the blood and blood pressure itself. Last time we've been looking at the cardiovascular system, we introduced it, and we were talking about the structures and how the blood flow within the heart itself. So today we'll look at blood as a subtype topic under cardiovascular system. So to begin with, we are going to start with the blood pressure. So let's see what is this blood pressure that we're talking about. So we are saying that blood pressure, actually, all in all, this is just the pressure that is going to be exerted within the arteries as the blood is flowing within it. That's what we mean when we say the blood pressure. It is something that is even palpable. You can able to palpate the pressure that the blood is exerting as it is passing through the walls of the blood vessels, in this case the arteries. So the blood pressure in the arteries is higher than it is with the veins. If you can remember where we were talking about the structures of the blood vessels last time, and we saw that the arteries, actually they've got the narrow lumen. So having that its lumen is very narrow, blood moves at a greater pressure compared than it is with the veins. The veins, blood moves at a lower pressure. So the pressure within the arteries results from the discharge of the blood from the left ventricle from the aorta. So when you are talking about the blood pressure, just like we have already mentioned that actually in this case we are talking about the pressure of blood that we can able to palpate in the arteries, we know that the arteries, they carry oxygenated blood that comes from the left ventricle of the heart. So in this case, all what we are concerned with, it is actually the left ventricle of the heart, because it is the one that pumps blood to all parts of the body through the aorta, just like we saw last time. And we're going to do the recap of the flow of blood now in the arteries. We are going to go out of the heart now within the arteries. So you appreciate the information to say that actually the blood that circulates within the body in the arteries, it actually comes from the left ventricle of the heart. So we are saying that when the ventricle of the heart contracts, it pushes its blood into the aorta, and from the aorta to the arteries. That's why even when the person, you take the blood pressure of the person, you're going to write systolic pressure. That systolic pressure that you're going to talk, that you are going to indicate on your chart, indicates the pressure at which the left ventricle of the heart is able to eject the blood. So the contraction of the left ventricle to eject the blood is called systolic blood pressure. And now there's a pressure of blood that is going to be felt when the left ventricle of the heart is not contracting and the heart is resting. Remember in the cardiac cycle, we talked about the contraction of the atria, contraction of the left of the ventricles, and the resting phase. So the pressure that you are going to that is going to be exerted within the blood vessels, or rather the arteries to be specific, when the heart is not contracting but it is relaxing, that is what we call the diastolic pressure. That's why you find that when you're taking a blood pressure or the patient, you are going to write something that looks like what is shown here using the sphygmomanometer. You are going to write BP is equals to systolic blood pressure over diastolic blood pressure millimeters of mercury. So what this means is that the systolic pressure, this is the pressure that is felt within the blood vessels when the left ventricle of the heart contracts. Then the diastolic pressure, it is the pressure that is going to be felt within the blood vessels when the heart it is resting. There's no contraction that is taking place. So this is what we are talking about. So we are saying that the blood pressure is measured using a sphygmomanometer. This is just the BP machine that we all know. This is the manual one. But you get to learn about the digital BP machines that are used. So now, what influences the pumping, or rather the blood pressure? Having said that is the pressure that you're going to feel within the blood vessels, but what factors affect this pressure of blood within the blood vessels? The first thing, it is cardiac output. Remember what we said cardiac output is. Cardiac output, actually, it is the product of the stroke volume multiplied by the number of rates the heart pumps blood. So the amount of blood that is contained within the circulatory system, it is going to alter or affect the blood pressure. If we've got the large volume of blood, it means that actually we are going to have a high blood pressure, because the blood will be having the pressure to pass through the vessels. The other factor, it is a peripheral resistance. Peripheral resistance, we're just talking about the contractility or elasticity of the blood vessels, more especially the peripheral extremities, because this is where we are going to even feel the blood pressure, like the legs, the arms. So the amount or the extent at which the blood vessels can enlarge to allow blood to pass, it is going to influence the blood pressure. So this means that when the peripheral resistance is high, in a sense that the blood vessels cannot expand, cannot enlarge when blood is passing, there will be greater pressure compared to how it can be when the blood vessels are dilating or increasing in size to allow the blood to pass through them. Then the strength of the contraction. This is actually the pumping action of the heart. How strong are the muscles of the heart? If the heart actually it is having the greater pressure, even the pressure of the blood is going to increase, because large amount of volume it is going to be exerted within the blood vessels. And the thickness and the volume of blood. In this case, there are instances whereby, for example, if at all there's a loss of blood that has occurred, or there's an edema, a patient is edematous, the blood fluid is going to seep from the blood vessels into the tissues, and the blood itself, it is going to remain concentrated within the blood vessels, which is the cells of the blood. So when they become concentrated, it means they are going to increase their thickness, having challenges to pass through the blood vessels, and this can increase the blood pressure. We also have an emotional state. Every extreme alters the blood pressure. It may increase the blood pressure. Being overexcited or being overstressed, all these can increase the blood pressure. Age. It is believed that as a person is advancing in age, the blood pressure also increases. And that of the infants, it increases. But the normal adult, the blood vessels is the blood pressure actually it is normal, because these influential factors are improved compared to how it is with the elders. You find that their elasticity of the blood vessels gets to be weak, or the blood vessels, they do not dilate more effectively. And also sex, it also influences the blood pressure. So you find that mostly in women, the blood pressure tends to be high compared to how it is with the men, due to the fact of having the narrow lumen where the blood passes through. And general health condition. It could be that when a person, it is he or she is sick, and the condition that this person is presenting with, they affect the heart. It is affecting cardiovascular system. It means that the blood pressure is going to be altered in whichever the case. It could be high or low. Other conditions, they will tend to increase the blood pressure, but others, they will reduce the blood pressure. So what you are saying, that the general condition or health of the person can also have an impact on the blood pressure. So when the blood pressure levels stays at 140 over 90 or higher than that, the person can be concluded to have high blood pressure. The normal average of blood pressure, it is 120 over 80. So the systolic pressure should be at 120, and the diastolic pressure should be at 80. But when it increases more than 140, it means that this person is having high blood pressure. And the diastolic pressure, when it goes beyond 90, it is actually considered as a high blood pressure. But still, there are levels of high blood pressure. There's what we call mild, there's severe, and there's moderate. We are going to see all those things. So we're saying that persistent or chronic high blood pressure may cause the heart work to be harder, and increases the chances of the person to have a stroke, heart attack and the kidney problems. Why? Because we find that most of these are systems that latch, they work together. So in a sense that when the person is having high blood pressure, which is persistent or chronic, there are many of the health conditions that may result, like these that we have mentioned down here. So the types of blood pressure, in this case, we are saying that there's a primary and secondary blood pressure. And this is denoted when you are describing this diagram here, that is aiding or helping us to understand what we mean when we say high primary or high blood pressure. So in this case, the blood pressure can be mild. High blood pressure can be mild. And what we mean by this? You find that a systolic pressure will be at 140, which is still high. So 140 to 159. And the diastolic pressure, when it is at 90 over or to 99, it means that this is mild hypertension, which is high blood pressure. And the moderate, it is 160 to 179, which is systolic pressure. And the diastolic pressure at 100 or to 109 is a range. So when it is at this range, it means that the person is having moderate high blood pressure. And for the severe high blood pressure, which is greater than 180, if you've got the systolic pressure, which is more than 180, and the diastolic pressure, which is more than 110, then the patient, it is at, he or she is at a higher risk or life-threatening condition. And this is a severe high blood pressure. But the normal range of blood pressure, it begins somewhere from 90. Systolic pressure should at least be at 100 to 139 or 90 to 139 as a range. Then the diastolic pressure should be at 65 to somewhere 110 below that. That would be considered as a normal range of blood pressure with an average of 120 to 80 over 80 millimeters of mercury. So we talked about the blood pressure. The other term that you need to understand when you're looking at the blood, it is the pulse. The pulse in this case, these are just the waves that are going to be felt in an artery as the blood is moving within it. So the waves that are going to be made, actually this pulse denotes the number of heartbeats that are being made. So when you take the pulse, you palpate the pulse from the artery, you get 60 beats of pulse. It means that the heart is actually able to beat 60 times in a minute. So when you say the pulse, in this case, we are saying that this is actually the wave of distension that is felt in an artery, wall due to the contraction of the left ventricle when forcing blood into the aorta that is going to send the blood into the arteries. So when the aorta is distended, a wave passes through the walls of the artery and it can be felt when an artery crosses the bone. Where the artery passes through the bone prominence, that's, those are the only sites where you can get the pulse. And we'll talk about those sites so that at least we can have an idea of where we can get this pulse from. So here we've got the visual aid that is going to help us to see some areas where you can have the pulse felt from. And these are some of the sites where the arteries actually, they close over the prominence of the bone. So this is what we are talking about. So in the head site, we have the temporal artery. The temporal artery, actually, this is the artery which supplies the head, specifically to the site of the ear, with the oxygenated blood. So just like it is showing here. So this is the temporal artery. We've got the facial artery. We've got the carotid arteries. Actually, these are the arteries that transport blood to the upper part of the body. We've got the brachiocephalic artery and the radial artery, femoral artery, popliteal artery, posterior tibial artery, dorsalis pedis artery. So these are some of the sites where the arteries, they close the bone prominence, and these are the sites that we can have the pulse being felt from. So you can try yourself on yourself or mostly on your friend, because there are possibilities whereby when you are palpating your own arteries, you'll be feeling the pulse from the thumbs or from the your fingers that you are using. We're going to demonstrate practically on how to palpate the artery or the pulse. So these are just the sites where the pulse can be felt. And we've got the side the factors that can affect the pulse as well, which is the pumping rate or the heart or the heart rate. So the first one is the position of the body. The position of the body alters the pulse. When it's in an upright position, the pulse tends to increase compared to how it is when you are lying down. And when you're in a strong emotions, both again, when you are overstressed or maybe you are overexcited, you are over happy, also the pulse is going to increase. When you are obese, because the heart will be trying to pump to compensate the whole sides of the body to pump to try to distribute or spread to supply blood with those sites, the pulse actually tends to increase. And the other medications that they've got the mechanism of increasing the pulse or the heart rate. And sometimes just temperature. The increase in temperature tends to increase the pulse. The heart will start pumping at a higher rate, leading to sweating. And that sweating makes the heat to be lost because it is over warm. So we're saying that the temperature can also increase the pulse. Having looked at all those terms, let's talk about the circulation of blood within the body. Now we are outside the heart. We have done looking at circulation within the heart. Now, how does the blood move from the heart to all parts of the body? So this diagram here that is shown, it is showing both pulmonary circulation and a systemic circulation as a brief form. So we can see that the blood will be coming from the heart going to the lungs and through the pulmonary artery, and from the lungs to the heart through the pulmonary veins. Then from the heart to all parts of the body through the aorta and back to the heart through the vena cava. We'll talk about this in details. So what is pulmonary circulation? Just like we have seen, pulmonary, bear in mind that you are dealing with the lungs. So you're talking about this circulation that involves the lungs in this case. So you're saying that the blood, it moves from the heart to the lungs and back to the heart again. And the circuit function is to bring blood close to the alveoli, where gaseous exchange takes place. So the heart is going to send the blood to the lungs just for oxygenation, unlike anything else, but it's just for the purpose of oxygenation. So the blood which is deoxygenated is going to enter through the heart, through the superior and inferior vena cava. So this is what we are talking about in terms of the pulmonary circulation. Sorry for the previous slide, it actually has to come after this one. So this is the pulmonary circulation that we were talking about. So the diagram is showing the blood coming from the heart to the lungs. Actually, when the pulmonary trunk or the pulmonary artery leaves the heart, it is going to bifurcate into two, the right and left pulmonary trunk to the lungs, to both lungs, right and left. And the same will happen with the oxygenated blood that is going to come from the lungs to the heart, according to the arrows that are helping us to understand what we are talking about. So back to the previous slide that we were talking. The heart, the blood which is deoxygenated blood, is going to enter the right atrium or the heart through from the superior and inferior vena cava. And from the right atrium, the blood which is deoxygenated is going to be pushed in the right ventricle through the tricuspid valves. And when the right ventricle gets filled up with the blood is going to be pushed to the lungs from the right ventricle through the pulmonary artery, which can also be said to be the pulmonary trunk. And the pulmonary artery, they are going to divide into left and right pulmonary arteries, which are going to send the deoxygenated blood to both lungs, in which is left and right. So as they are getting into the lungs, are going to bifurcate again. So in the right lung, we are going to have three arteries that are be sending the blood to the lungs. Why is it like that? We've got actually three lobes of the lungs, or three sections of the right lung. But with the left one, we only have two lobes, because the left lung is a bit smaller than it is with the right, to provide the more room, to provide the large space for the heart, because the apex of the heart, it is more to the left, unlike it is with the right. So we're saying that the lobar arteries, they further divide into smaller arteries, arterioles, and capillaries. from capillaries, it will be venules to veins, and the veins, the one that will be bringing blood to the heart. Remember what we talked about in the previous lesson in terms of how the arteries, they exchange blood with the veins. So in each lung, the capillaries, they join up together to form two pulmonary veins. And these two pulmonary veins, they retain the oxygenated blood to the heart, two from each lung. So we've got four pulmonary veins, which brings oxygenated blood to the lungs. So during arterial system, the blood which is in the left atrium is going to be pumped into the left ventricle. And from the left ventricle, the blood is going to be pushed through the aorta to be sent to the systemic circulation, which brings us to the second circulation. So we've got pulmonary circulation and systemic circulation. So we are done with the pulmonary circulation. Now with the systemic circulation, we see that when the blood is distributed in the aorta, it is going to be sent to all parts of the body containing oxygen and nutrients. And the blood is going to be coming from the systemic circulation through the veins containing the metabolic waste that have to be excreted from the body. But how does this happen? So we're saying that in systemic circulation, blood moves from the heart to the rest part of the body and back to the heart. And the oxygenated blood is going to move from the left atrium into the left ventricle, and the contraction of the left ventricle is going to push to force blood to go into the aorta. So from the aorta, oxygenated blood is going to be distributed to the various routes over the systemic circulation. We are going to start having the branches of the arteries that will be branching from the aorta. Now, what are these arteries that will be branching from the aorta that we are talking about in this case? So we're saying that the aorta is the main artery. So the largest artery which carries oxygenated blood is actually the aorta. That's why it is said to be the great vessels from the blood, from the heart itself. So this aorta is going to carry oxygenated blood, where the arteries that will be branching from the aorta will be carrying oxygenated blood to the tissues of the body. And from the tissues of the body, now, as it is leaving the heart, the very aorta, as it is leaving the heart, it is going to divide into three. Actually, the aorta is divided into three parts. We've got an ascending of aorta, we've got an arc of aorta, and we've got the descending aorta. So, this descending aorta, it is the one that enters into the abdomen and becomes the abdominal artery, and we're going to discuss all these branches of artery. And as it is descending, it will come the diaphragm or aortic hiatus, and it is then be called the abdominal aorta, just like we have said already in this case. Okay, we're supposed to have the visual aid here that is showing the descending aorta that we are talking about, or the arc of an aorta, but never mind, we'll demonstrate that as we go further. So this arc of this aorta, as it is descending down, it ends at the lower border of the fourth lumbar vertebra by dividing into the right and the left common iliac. So we said it will come from the aorta, it will be the thoracic aorta. From thoracic aorta, it will become abdominal aorta. From the abdomen, it is going to divide at the level of the fourth lumbar vertebra. Then it is going to become the right and left iliac arteries. So this was about the aorta. So the first two branches of an aorta, as it is leaving the heart, and take note of this, in your exams, these questions are there. They ask you, what are the first two branches of aorta? These are actually the left and the right coronary arteries. These are the arteries which supplies the heart with oxygenated blood. The blood that goes through the heart to the lungs for oxygenation and back to the lungs to the systemic circulation has nothing to do with the heart itself. But the heart receives nourishment, and its metabolic products get to be excreted through the veins and the arteries that branches from the major veins, vessels. So in this case, it receives its nourishment and the oxygen from the coronary arteries. So the arc of an aorta, again, it is going to have three branches. After the branching of the coronary artery, at the arc of an aorta, we're going to have three branches. The first one will have the brachiocephalic trunk or brachiocephalic artery, which is going to divide into the subclavian artery and the right common carotid artery. And you have another one, which is the left common carotid artery and the left subclavian artery. These three, again, you need to know them to your level best. Need to know the three branches of the arc of an aorta, which in this case is brachiocephalic artery, left common carotid artery, and the left subclavian artery. So the common carotid artery, they supply the head and the neck with the oxygenated blood. So each one divides into two at the level of the thyroid cartilage to form the external and internal arteries. So take note of this. So as these arteries are ascending, they are going to divide into external and the internal carotid arteries. So the external carotid artery, they are going to supply the parts of the upper part of the head, which is specifically in this case the face and the scalp, with the oxygenated blood. Through from these small arteries that will be branching, like the facial, temporal, occipital, and maxillary branches. Then the internal carotid artery, it is going to supply the brain, so to speak. The brain, which is the cerebrum, the eyes, the nose, and the forehead. So these are going to be supplied with the internal carotid arteries. So as these arteries are ascending, these carotid arteries, again, they are going to divide into the carotid sinuses, where they are going to meet with the sensory nerves. So these are the sensory nerves that will be having the mechanism of detecting an abnormality that can be found within the blood. If there's any changes that has happened to the blood, these sensory nerves are going to detect that and bring the problem to normal. And now within the heart, there's where they are going to make a circle-like, where the arteries are going to meet. And this site, it is what we call the circle of Willis. And this question also, it is examinable. You'll be asked about the circular sartiosus. It is called the circle of Willis. And this one is function. That's what we learned last time when we were saying that they are actually anastomosis arteries, which when one it is occluded, the other one will pick up with the function of supplying the vital organs. Vital organs, they need blood at each and every time. They need oxygen for them to function. So in an instance whereby one it is occluded, we need an alternative, which is actually the anastomosis. And in the brain, this causes what we call the circle of Willis. And this is what we are talking about. So we can see the arteries are coming from the left common carotid artery and the right common carotid arteries. And they meet here at the circulus of arteriosus and making what we call the circle of Willis. Okay, so we are just describing what have already been said, to say that this anastomosis, it increases the likelihood of an adequate blood supply even when one blood vessel gets to be occluded. So this is to ensure that every time the vital organs are supplied with the blood. So the blood is supplied to the upper limb. The upper limb, in this case, we're talking about the hands, through one main artery called the subclavian artery. So we've got the right subclavian artery and the left subclavian artery. So these limbs are going to be supplied with blood from the subclavian artery. And they are slightly arced and are passed behind the clavicles and over the first rib before entering the axilla. So the clavicle is actually the collarbone. So we're saying that these subclavian artery, they are going to bypass the behind the clavicles or the collarbones before they protrude to the axilla, which is the armpits, where it passes through in order to connect to the limbs to supply the blood to the arms. The axilla artery, it lies in the axilla, just like we have mentioned, and the first part lies deeply then it runs more superficially to become the brachial artery. So actually the brachial artery, it is just on the upper apex of the arm, on the upper part of the elbow. That's where we're going to find the brachial artery. Mostly this is the site where we used to get the BP from. So we'll demonstrate with this as we are going further so that we can see where the brachiocephalic, or rather the brachial artery, it is found. So this brachial artery, as it is descending down to supply the arm with the blood, oxygenated blood, it is going to divide to form the radial and the ulnar arteries. So this is actually at the distal part of the arm in this case. And the radial artery, it passes down the radial and the lateral side of the forearm to the wrist. And just above the wrist, they are going to form the something that looks like round, like a sac of Willis, like it is, so as it will form the continuity of the blood supply in this case. And this is what we call the palmar artery, which is going to be formed, and we'll talk about it as we are going further. So we're saying that the artery then passes between the first and the second metacarpal bones and enters into the palm of the hand. After they enter into the palm of the hand, what happens? The ulnar artery runs down the inner side of the forearm to the wrist, which crosses the superficial palmar arc. So this is what I was talking about. So they'll form the superficial palmar arc. We are going to see what this looks like. So the palmar arcs are anastomosis between the radial and the palmar arc. They are going to join at the end. This is what we mean when we say anastomosis, because there's a joining of the two branches of the arteries. And they supply the blood to the hand and fingers. So to ensure that these peripheral parts have got the blood, that's why there's this anastomosis that is going to be formed by these blood vessels. So here we can see the diagram that is demonstrating what we have been talking about. So from the upper part where the blood vessels is coming from the heart, it is going to come from the subclavian artery, just like we have mentioned. Subclavian artery, then it is going to go behind the clavicle bone to go into the axilla artery. From axilla artery, we are going to see the brachial artery as it is demonstrating here. From the brachial artery, it is going to divide into two, ulnar artery and the radial artery. And from the radial artery, at the end, distal end, we are going to have the palmar arc that is going to be formed when the radial and the ulna gets to be linked together. So this is what we've been demonstrating or talking about. So the blood supply to the thorax, we are done with the blood supply to the arms or to the upper limbs. Then we are getting back to the blood supply to the thorax, which is in the chest now, in the chest cavity. So I'm saying that the thorax involves the branches of the thoracic aorta, which supply the structures in the chest. Which one are these? From the branch of this thoracic aorta, we are going to have the bronchial arteries, which supplies the blood to the lungs, specifically in the bronchioles. And we have esophageal arteries, which is going to supply the blood with the esophagus with oxygenated blood. We also have intercostal arteries, which is going to supply the intercostal muscles. These are muscles actually that holds the ribs together, that actually helps in the respiratory mechanism. And the abdomen is going to be supplied with the blood from the abdominal aorta that we talked about earlier. When the aorta gets to start descending, it is going to become the thoracic aorta. From thoracic aorta, is going to become an abdominal aorta. So this is what we are talking about in this case. So it has many large branches as arteries, which arises from and supply the abdominal organs. So from the main abdominal aorta, there will be many branches that will be supplying the organs or the abdomen in this case. And the branch of the abdominal aorta, the first one, there's a phrenic artery which supplies the diaphragm with oxygenated blood. And from there, we're also going to have the cardiac trunk, which arises just below the diaphragm. And it will have some of the branches again, like the gastric artery, which supplies the stomach with oxygenated blood. We also have the hepatic artery, which will be supplying the liver and the duodenum and the pancreas, as well as the part of the stomach with oxygenated blood. We also have the splenic artery, and this splenic artery will be supplying the spleen with oxygenated blood. From there, we have the superior mesenteric artery, which will be supplying the small intestines with oxygenated blood, and the proximal part of the large intestines. And we have the inferior mesenteric artery down, which will be supplying the distal half of the large intestines, and the part of the rectum with oxygenated blood. And we have middle adrenal arteries, which will be actually supplying the adrenaline gland with the oxygenated blood. And we'll have the renal arteries, renal from the term kidney. So this one will be supplying the kidney with oxygenated blood. Worry not, we are going to see the diagram of all these arteries that we are talking about. Then we'll have gonadal arteries, which will be supplying the ovarian follicles of the women actually with oxygenated blood. And we'll have the testicular arteries in men, which will be supplying the blood to the testicles, as it has already been said that after the organ which they are named after, which are the testicles in this case. And we have the aorta at the fourth lumbar vertebra, divides into the common iliac, just like we mentioned. This has been repeatedly, so it is describing at the iliac arteries that we have talked about. So in this case, from the abdominal aorta, the blood now will be coming from the iliac arteries, which will be supplying the blood to the peripheral or the lower limbs in this case. So the abdominal aorta is going to divide into the right and the left iliac artery. So you're saying that this iliac artery, they will be supplying the pelvis, the perineum, and the gluteal region, which is the among the pelvic region here. And the external iliac artery will be supplying the lower limbs. So we've got two, the internal and the external one. So the external one, it is going to be supplying the blood to the femoral artery, which are the lower limbs. So from the femoral artery, it is going to descend to the popliteal artery, just like it was demonstrated in the first diagram that we were talking about. And this is what we have been talking about. So here we can see how the branches are made. From the aorta, it is going to descend in the coeliac trunk that we are talking about in this case. From coeliac trunk, it is going to come to the mesenteric arteries, which supplies to the intestines. Then we have renal arteries, just like we had demonstrated, the gonadal artery. We have inferior mesenteric artery and a common iliac. So these common iliac are the one now that will start dividing into those small arteries that we were talking about, that we can see on this diagram now. So from iliac arteries, so come at the pelvic region, where it is showing the internal iliac artery and the external iliac artery in this case. So we can see that from the iliac artery, we are going to have the femoral artery. Femoral artery, we are going to have the popliteal artery. Let's follow that one which appears red. The blue one, it is the vena cava, or rather the veins. But the red one from a femoral, we have a popliteal artery. From popliteal artery, we are going to have anterior tibial artery. From that, we have from anterior tibial artery, we are going to have perineal artery, and we have posterior tibial artery at the end there. So that's how the blood supply, it is going to be formed from the heart in the systemic circulation. So this one, it is just describing all those arteries that we have seen. So from the tibial arteries, the tibial artery is going to supply the structures in front of the leg, which is in the anterior part. Then the posterior tibial artery, it is going to supply the posterior part of the leg, including the ankles, the joints of the legs down there, and making the plantar arch, just like it was in the Palmer Arc. So near its origin, it gives off a larger branch called the peroneal artery, which supplies the lateral aspect of the leg, which is the insides now in this case. From there, after looking at the supply of blood, we can talk about the blood itself. What is the blood in this case? So, just like we already know, I guess we have an idea. In this case, when you say the blood, we are talking about the connective tissue that you are going to find in the circulatory system or in the blood vessels. That's the blood that we're talking about. So this is actually the transportation medium for oxygen and the nutrients to the cells. And also this is where the metabolic waste are going to be transported from the point of manufacture or where they are being produced to the external surface of the body through the blood. So I said that the blood is actually the vital in transporting substances between the cells and the external environment, just like we have already talked about. And it also helps in the maintaining of the internal environment of the body in the regulatory mechanism. And it comprised of three types of cells, which is the red blood cells, the white blood cells, and the platelets. So these are some of the composition that we are going to find in the blood. Now, what are the functions of the blood in this case? One, the blood carries oxygen from the lungs so that it can be distributed to all parts of the body. And it carries the carbon dioxide from the tissues to the external surface of the body. It also carries nutrients from the GIT, which is gastrointestinal tract, to supply it to the cells, and also carries the metabolic waste that are being produced from the cell to the external surface of the body. The blood also carries heat. We know the heat distribution, which is the thermoregulation, it is contained within the blood. And it also carries the hormones from the glands to the distant cells that could be the effectors that need to be stimulated to produce the function. Yeah, so the hormones of the endocrine system, they are ductless. They are released within the blood and being distributed to the targeted site. So these functions are played by the blood. And also this blood, it carries protective substances like antibodies. And we'll talk about these antibodies as we are going on. So all these are the functions of the blood. And it is a communication link between the cells of the body. The composition of the blood, in this case, the blood volume varies with our body size, just like we know. But the average size of an adult blood volume, it is about 5 liters. So according to the average of an adult, it is said that contains 5 liters of blood, which is 5,000 mils. And a blood sample is usually about 45% made up of cells. So when you get the blood of itself, 45% of that blood as a tissue, it contains 45% of cells. And the 55% of these cells that we're talking about, the white blood cells, the red blood cells, and the platelets. Then the 55%, it is composed of the plasma. And this plasma, it is just the fluid part of the blood containing the plasma proteins, the carbohydrates, the lipids, the vitamins, hormones, and other electrolytes within the body. But the cells, they make up 45%. Okay, so what is the plasma? So we're saying that approximately this plasma, 92% of the plasma itself, it is composed of just fluid, the water. And the 10%, it is composed of those substances that we talked about, like the plasma proteins and the food minerals that are transported within it, like amino acids, the glucose, the lipids, and all those things that we talked about. And the types of plasma proteins that are contained within the blood plasma, there's albumins, the globulins, and the fibrinogens. Other plasma membrane, plasma proteins, in this case, their function is just to maintain the homeostasis within the body. They regulate the amount of fluid that is to be found within the blood vessels, and also the amount of fluids that are to be found within the tissues. And the cellular contents of the blood, we've got the red blood cells, we've got white blood cells, and platelets. So red blood cells, scientifically are said to be erythrocytes, white blood cells are leukocytes, platelets are said to be thrombocytes. So these are the only cells of the blood tissue. So the red blood cells, for today we are going just to talk about blood cells, red blood cells as part of the component of the blood. So first thing on the red blood cells, what you need to understand, it is that its shape, it is of biconcave discs, and the main function of these red blood cells is to carry oxygen, because they contain the hemoglobin, which is the protein, and this hemoglobin, it gets to be combined with the oxygen, making up what we call oxyhemoglobin, and making, when it is containing the blood, in this case it is going to have the lighter or the bright red color. And when oxygen is used by the cells, they carry carbon dioxide that is taken to the lungs for oxygenation. You find that the blood appears dark in color. That's why you see that when the person is injured and the injury is not that much deep, the blood that will be coming out will appear dark. Why? Because it's coming from the veins that are just superficially, and these veins, they carry deoxygenated blood. But when the injury is deep, in a sense that the arteries are ruptured, the blood will appear bright or light and thick, and less in dense. This denotes the arteries and the oxygen that is carried within these blood vessels. So the red blood cells, it doesn't have the nucleus. It only has a nucleus when it is not fully matured, but as it is maturing, the nucleus gets to be perished, or it gets to be destroyed, so as to increase the surface area for the hemoglobin, which is the protein substance essential for carrying oxygen. And by so doing, having that it doesn't have the nucleus, it doesn't go cell division, but only the blood is being produced from the bones, because we know that the lifespan of the red blood cells, it is actually 120 days. So when the blood cell stays for 120 days, it gets to die, and it gets to be replaced through the production of another new blood within the red bone marrows in the bone. And the red blood cells is influenced by the negative feedback mechanism, which we say that when there's a lesser volume of red blood cells within the blood vessels, there will be the hormone erythropoietin that is going to be produced by the kidneys and the liver, that is going to influence the bones to produce a number of blood cells. And when this is compensated, you find that the production of red blood cells is going to decrease again. So the increased rate of production continues as long as the kidney and the liver continues producing the erythropoietin when there is an experience of oxygen deficiency, that is as a result of reduced amount of red blood cells. So when the red blood cell supply, it is insufficient, erythropoietin, it is going to stop being produced. Hence, there will be the falling in the red blood cells production. So this has been for today, friends. Thank you very much for your time. And thank you for listening and being attention to this. Remember that this is a very essential topic that we have been looking at. So you need to be able to know those arteries that we have talking about. You need to know which artery supplies which organ with oxygenated blood. Next time we meet, we are going to continue looking at the veins and the venous return of blood. Thank you very much for your time.